All right, so data is good, but we also like to see if we can apply this to clinical practice. So I chose some cases from the samples that we tested to really highlight how T2 could potentially impact our clinical decision-making, our decisions at the bedside. The first case is a 73-year-old female with cancer who is being treated, and she was in the hospital for pneumonia. She's in the hospital for a long period of time, and on day 12, she had a blood culture positive for Pseudomonas. The team started her on cefepime and cipro, which are appropriate antibiotics, while they were awaiting sensitivities, antibiotic sensitivities. Subsequent blood cultures after she was started on antibiotics were negative. So, you know, we assumed that she was successfully treated for this bacteremia. In any case, she deteriorated, she developed septic shock and was intubated. So on day 17, while working up the etiology of her septic shock, she got a respiratory culture. The respiratory culture grew 100 CFU of Acromobacter and 100 CFUs of Pseudomonas. So this is a very unimpressive respiratory culture. By no means would we say she had a pneumonia. We do need to look at her amylase level and her neutrophils, but pretty unimpressive. Antibiotics were not changed. We have a sample from this day. 5 years ago, we tested this sample with our T2 test, and the sample was positive for Pseudomonas. Blood cultures were negative on that day. 3 days later, her respiratory culture grew 100,000 Acromobacter shock. She was a very sick patient, you know, regardless, and we're not sure if the outcome would have changed, but this highlights a very unique role of T2 when cultures are negative.